Yes, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be here with you. And so this talk is about technology, not so much about a product. And here is this. There are so many buttons. Which one should be? Yeah? The lower one, okay. So first we will analyze what is special about forensic tools and what special requirements they have. The second part is a technology assessment of the Rust programming language and its ecosystem. Then finally we will see a case study using Rust as development platform for a forensic tool. And at the end, we will see a live demonstration. So I try to get this theoretic part as short as possible, that I can show you how things work at the end. So shortly about forensics. Who likes crime stories? Yeah. So you know what forensics is. Yeah. These are these guys in their protective suits, and they come to the crime scene. So, more in general, forensic is the use of science and technology to investigate and establish facts in criminal or civil courts of law. And this is usually done by relating traces to human acts using highly standardized methods. Digital forensics is kind of similar. Here, the forensic investigator, he tries to prove a human-system interaction. And the first step always consists to conserve the system state. And this is done by copying all memory that is related to the crime, disk memory, or all kind of memory, in so-called image files. And these image files are then later analyzed using forensic software. Image files are big. So why are they so big? Because the system storage is so big. So it's very common that you have to deal with terabytes of data and try to find those some bytes that are significant that can prove that something has happened. So to find these meaningful bytes, we use specialized software, forensic tools, and this will lead us to the first requirements. So, since images are huge, our software needs to be fast. So what we need is code efficiency. Furthermore, these images, they may or very often contain malicious code. These exploit vulnerabilities of our forensic tools. I will come to this later. So why should we care about it? First, we should care because this may warn our adversary that an investigation is going on. And secondly, it opens an attack vector to our investigator machine. So both things what we really do not want in our environment. To protect against the last attack vector, what we need is memory safety. Memory safety is a property of programming languages. So some programming languages are memory safe, some are not. For example, C and C++ is not memory safe, and Java is memory safe. If you're more interested about these technical details, then please ask at the end, and we can talk about this a little bit more. This was one too much. Sorry, I'm a little bit lost. Yeah, Yeah, let's talk a little bit about the Rust programming language. So for many years, program efficiency and memory safety seemed to be an insurmountable discrepancy. So now a relatively new programming language tries to cope with this balancing act. So this, the Rust programming language developed by Mozilla. And it offers code efficiency by its zero cost abstractions and the fact that it doesn't have a garbage collector. So no runtime is necessary to for its memory safety guarantees. So memory safety, so Rust's unique and innovative approach is what they call is data ownership. It is a way to find semantics to guarantee that little piece in memory is only accessed by one piece of code at the same time. And so the most elegant way of doing it is they can do it at compile time. So they do not need a runtime to check that it's only one piece of code accessing a certain memory at a time. Also, if you're interested in this, we can go to this later. I'll go more into detail of it later. And that it happens at compile time, this is what makes it so fast, compared to Java, who also gives some of these guarantees, but you have a runtime engine doing it at runtime. So, is Rust a suitable choice for forensic tool development? To answer this question, I carried out a case study and developed a forensic tool with Rust. And let's see what it should do. Only two buttons and I got the wrong one. So the tool I will present you now is the GNU Strings alternative. GNU Strings is a little tool that is used by forensic investigators to extract ASCII human readable data out of binary data. And so GNU Strings is 19 years old now, and it works quite well, but it also has some shortcomings. One of the shortcomings is its lacking of multibyte encoding, and the second shortcoming is it has no guaranteed memory safety. Also, we will come back to this a little bit later. But first, multibyte encoding, what is it? It is when you have a character that is represented in memory with more than one byte. So the most prominent one is maybe UTF-8, what you know. There are certain characters that are encoded with 6 bytes in memory. Another very important encoding is UTF-16. A little endian. It is important because Windows use this encoding internally in memory, so you find this in memory. What you see here is some test data. So this is a file that with different scripts. And so this file is encoded in UTF-16. And let's see what GNU Strings can find when it scans this file. And here you see, yeah, it finds something, but only ASCII. So all the other scripts, they kind of disappear. You will never see them, or you can never detect this information. So this lack of memory safety, it is also important because in 2014 there had been a vulnerability related to memory safety. And so the author of the bug report entitled this security advisory, "Don't run strings on untrusted files." And this is kind of hard for forensic investigators because he only has untrusted files. Yeah? So this is really bad. And this is this kind of attack vector I have been talking about. So now we come to the case study, and let's do things better. So I developed a tool which is called StringsXt, which is a secure GNU strings alternative with multibyte encoding support for many encodings. Here you see some of these implemented in Rust. And now here you see its architecture. So the binary data is cut into slices. These slices are then fed into scanners, and each scanner scans for one encoding, so you can scan several encodings at the same time. The findings are then merged into one output stream. And let's see what StringsXt can find. And here, this is, I ran it on the same test data, and you see it can find all these scripts in your data. My recommendation, so after the six months of hacking, I found some bugs in some libraries. One of them resulted in incorrect sorting, ordering. It was not diff. Also, yeah, this is. It's related to the fact that Rust is a relatively young programming language. Yeah. So there are more bugs in its libraries. But Rust is memory safe, which is really, really important, because these kind of vulnerabilities are really, really hard to detect. We have some tools, there are some possibilities, but this is, so if you have the choice, then, so we have much, much better tools to find bugs in our development than everything that is memory safety related. For example, this bug I showed you, so it was for 10 years it was for 10 years hidden in this software, and probably there are still others. So my recommendation is you use Rust for your forensic tool development. It meets all the requirements we have set up at the beginning. I only showed you some of the most important requirements, but yeah, I can strongly recommend, and we have enough time now to show you the live demonstration. What I like about live demonstration is you never know if it works or not. Yeah, so we will find out in 2 minutes. I need to switch here the screen for a moment.
Maybe while we do this, maybe somebody has some pop-up questions straight away about Rust language.
Yeah. Yeah. So okay, I have to activate the screen. The right resolution, what is the right resolution for this monitor? Maybe this. Yeah, maybe this. Yeah, I think this can do.
So.
Strings. Yeah, yeah. This, yeah.
Getting strings out of the binaries, but how it helps to identify somebody, or are you using snapshots just of ASCII strings?
No. You use many, many, many tools, and very specialized tools, yeah, to analyze your snapshots. But so when you have an image, then you're interested in all human readable stuff. It can, for example, there can be some URLs somewhere in these binaries, and this gives you an indication of what you can expect. Yeah. So this is just one little tool that is used, but it's very commonly used. So every forensic investigator has it somewhere in his toolbox, but this is only one little thing of hundreds and hundreds of software that is out there. And many of this software is very specialized. Yeah, this is just this is a scanner. Yeah, did I answer your question? Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. So then let's see what GNU Strings. So remember, GNU Strings is the software that is 19 years old now. What it can do. Here, this is the name of the binary. So I will search for UTF-16 big endian, and I will scan one partition of my hard disk. Yeah, it's one partition here in this laptop. This is raw data I'm scanning. Yeah, so I'm not analyzing the file system. I go through the raw data and I just have a look of anything human readable. What can we find in this data? So I launch it. It should take a second, and we find something. Yeah, and surprisingly, so I have here, this is a Linux box, and there is some Apple inside. Yeah, don't ask me why there is Apple inside, but it can be interesting, and it can be, let's say, first hint, what we should look for. That's all we find. Yeah, in the whole partition, there is nothing more. I compare it to the new development, StringsXt. I scan the same partition, you see it here. And this time I scan for UTF-16 big endian and UTF-16 little endian in parallel at the same time. So this is what this tool can do it. Strings cannot do it, you have to run it several times, and let's see what we can find here. Oh, what happened here with my hard disk? Has China hacked my laptop? What do you think? Actually, yes, yeah. Any ideas what happened to my laptop? Why do we see so many Chinese messages here? Nobody speaks Chinese in this room, no? So actually, no, but your idea is right, yeah? So when you see the UTF-16 encoding, it has, so there are about, I think 60,000 symbols defined in this encoding, and most of the symbols are some Asian letters. And the reason why we see so many of these Asian letters is because there are so many. And when you just have a random number stream, and you interpret these bytes as UTF-16. Then there's a big chance that you will see a lot of Chinese, even it has no meaning. Yeah, this is why I was asking if some of you speaks Chinese to confirm that it doesn't mean anything what we see here. Yeah, a hint could be that so even in Chinese, some meaningful things should have more symbols in a row. Yeah, but so I cannot read really these things. So this is bad. It's kind of useless. Yeah. So what can be done? So what should we do? Do you have an idea? Yeah. Remember the. So what we try to do? We try to find human readable information in binary data. This is one possibility. Yes. So then you need a semantic model. So you need to know what are meaningful words. This is one possibility. And you need this for all possible languages that can be encoded. Yeah, but it's possible. Let's see, in theory, it's possible. Another way is to apply a filter and to say, okay, I'm only searching for a certain Unicode point range. I limit this, yeah? And I say, okay, all these 2,000 Chinese symbols, yeah, at the moment, I'm not interested in them. Yeah, so I certainly, there are many, many other scripts and languages we could find. So at the moment, we do not want any Chinese. This is done here. So here, I restrict this filter first to pure ASCII. So these are the code points for pure ASCII. And here to this range, which captures all European languages, Armenian, Arab, Greek, so everything that is not Asian, you can find, or let's say most of the things that are not Asian, you can find them in this Unicode range. Let's see. Yes, so you might recognize this we know already. Yeah, all the rest, what you see at the screen now, we wouldn't. So we haven't found with the original strings tools. For example, here, let's say here this is some Cyrillic. We have some Arab, and also here some ASCII messages that could be meaningful and could give us a hint what to look for in further investigations. So, this was the end of the demonstration. I still have 3 minutes. I come back to the slides. It was like this. Yeah. So this is not the purpose of this tool, yeah. So this would be then the next step to do, yeah. So this is always the first thing you do. You have a quick check, check about what human readable information could be in your data, and then you will use a tool, as you said, that knows about data structures. So I think you might mix up two concepts, yeah? So I did not restrict the search field, yeah? So I always went through the whole partition, so I did not leave one byte out. I just said that I restricted the Unicode range. Yeah, this is different to scripts that are meaningful for me. So, for example, in this encoding, what we have seen, this is not the right tool to find any meaningful Chinese information hidden in your binary. Yeah, there you need something else. So, yeah, I'm not sure. Have I answered your question? Okay. So yes, this is the last slide. So my message, please be aware that forensic software is also software, and it's vulnerable to attacks. This is why memory safety is very, very important. Most of the forensic software we use nowadays It's all written in C's, and it all has these kind of vulnerabilities I have been talking about. It is a real threat. Remember, an exploit may warn your adversary, and it opens an attack vector to compromise your investigator machine, and both is really, really bad for your investigation. So last comment from my side. StringsXt, you cannot buy it because it's free. Yeah, it's open source, it's free. You are invited to improve it and to contribute to it and to use it and to give feedback. Your feedback is welcome. And so I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Jan. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much for being a part of this conference.